My name is Eva Goetz, and it's a great pleasure to see so many of you at our webinar, at which we'll try to find out why English, which is really quite simple language if you compare it to other languages worldwide, why English becomes tricky at times, therefore is a bit difficult for us, especially for Poles. So, our webinar is entitled Tricky English or Confusing English, and it will be combined of few sections of areas which can cause possibly this confusion. So the first group of problematic words are false friends. The second one are words which are confusing in meaning. The third group are homophones, words that sound alike and they look differently, but they are pronounced in the same way. Then we look at some minimal pairs, so words which differ only by one little difference. And then we will have a quick look at homographs, and homographs have the same spelling, but they have different pronunciation and different meaning. And the last group are homonyms, so meanings of one word can differ depending on the context. All right, so here we go. After each section, we'll have a little mini quiz. So please stay tuned, be active, and write answers in your chat boxes. Because the chat box is quite small, I would need my glasses at some time. But now we start with false friends. All of us have got friends, and these are people whom we trust. These are people with whom we feel comfortable. False friends are opposites, are people whom we cannot trust. And this is true also about the language. We see words which seem nice, friendly, but they are not friendly. They can cause some problems because they have double face. Well, one of the commonly confused false friend, English-Polish false friend, is the word actual. This is the adjective and the adverb actually. Well, the true meaning of this word in English is real or really. So, for example, look at me. I have a German name, but I'm Polish. So, in English, I can say, my name is Goetz, but actually, I'm Polish, right? So, it means I'm really Polish, right? Eventually, this is probably number two in the league, in the list and ranking of Polish English false friends, because it means final or finally. Therefore, we can say eventually the peace talks finished with mutual agreement, or eventually we finished the project, or eventually the budget is ready for the next year. Well, number three, important especially for people who work with numbers, is the word billion. It has definitely different number of zeros, and we can say that there are over 7 billion people in the world. Well, actually, I don't know what's the exact figure now because it's growing every day, and probably now it's reaching 8 million. Don't know really. Chef, due to cooking programs which become more and more popular in Poland, we slowly started to understand the difference between boss, chief, and chef. So, chef is only in the kitchen, yes? It's a boss, but only in the area of cooking, in the restaurants, bars. So, chef's menu for this week is the following. The word mark looks very similar to what we use in Polish, but really it doesn't mean the brand like, I don't know, Nike, BMW, Rolls-Royce. Mark in English is a sign, usually a small one, which we put, for example, against some boxes. Or just recently we had elections in Poland, so we were supposed, as voters, we were supposed to put a mark beside the name of our candidate. So in the example, you can see how it works. Could you mark only correct answers? This word obscure at the first glance doesn't evoke positive connotations because the similar word in Polish is very negative, but it's not true in English, because in English obscure means unknown, unknown, remote, not popular. So we can say that we would like to go or travel to some obscure places. The example shows you how positive it is, or how positive it could be. Generally, it's a neutral word, but not as negative as in our language. Extra, the word comes from English in our language. It's originating from English, but it has changed the meaning. Because in English, extra doesn't mean extremely good, superb. It means additional. So if you say, I've got extra work, it doesn't mean you enjoy your work. It means that you have more load of work, right? So due to tight deadlines, for example, we can have a lot of extra work. So what you're doing now, it's your really extra time. I hope it's good as well, but it's extra meaning additional time devoted for learning languages. And again, the same connotation. The word ordinary is Polish-English false friend, because in our language it means something negative, something bad. Yes, in English it means that things or people or places are common, average, normal. And we can say, we've got the example with summer day, but we can say that today was one of those ordinary autumn days. Maybe not so ordinary because you're participating in a webinar, but to be serious, it's Thursday evening. And as we say in English, Thursday is a little Friday, so we can feel the spirit of weekend coming. So maybe it's not really an ordinary day. Rapport, please mind the pronunciation, is not something that you write or read or produce, it's the relationship. In my profession, it's extremely important. The expertise, knowledge, experience are important without any doubt, but it's very, very, very important to have good relationship, good rapport with your students, right? So Jenny, she's probably a good teacher or trainer, has excellent rapport with her students. Pension. It's not that we, relatively young people, get at the end of the month, although it's also a fixed amount which is received to the bank account. But this is money for retired people. And we can say that our grandma or our mom who is retired receives her pension at the end of each month. We receive salary. Once we get on the retirement, salary turns into pension. A rumor is not a sudden noise. I hope that you won't hear any rumor here. No, I'm joking, because rumor is not a sound. Rumor is a gossip, it's news. So if you hear the rumor, it doesn't mean you hear the sudden, violent and noisy sound, but it means that you have come across some informal news, for example, about changes in the company. Right, so I need my glasses because it's time for a little test. Do you remember any of these false friends? And if you do, could you adjust them with their true meaning? So what's the correct meaning of the word actual? What's the true meaning of the word ordinary? And what's the true meaning of the word extra? If you don't mind, could you write answers in your chat box? Yeah, I can see. Adrian, yes, very good. Richard as well. Mateusz, Eva. Okay, waiting for more answers, but there are plenty of them. Right, so here is the truth. Actual means real, Ordinary means common or normal. And extra means additional. So we need extra money for our holidays. All right, thank you. Well, words can be confusing, life can be confusing, and if we learn foreign language especially, there is a big room for confusion as well. One of the most confused pairs in English language is this one, borrow and lend. In Polish, we have only one verb to describe the action. In English, it differs depending what's the direction. So, in order to finish this investment, we have to borrow money from the bank. So, to borrow means to take, yes, to get from the bank or a book from the library. This is this direction. We are taking something. Whereas lend has the opposite direction. We are giving to somebody. Yeah. So could you lend me $50? In other words, could you give me $50? If you have doubts, replace these words with take for borrow and with give for lend. And that would make sure that you don't confuse these actions. Effective and efficient. Effective means more successful. So, for example, humor in conflict is often more effective than shouting. It gives better results. So effective is successful, giving better results, while efficient is producing more. Like in this example, the new machine is far more efficient than the old one. Economy and economics. The whole state of financial relations in the state or in the country is called economy. So we can say that Polish economy is doing quite well, or we can say, as in the example, that US economy has been recovering from severe crisis. While economics is science, so you study economics in order to be involved in creating, building up economy of your country. Anyway, each of us is doing this on a regular basis because working, paying taxes, being a consumer is also building up the economy of our state. Hard and hardly. We know that the word hard is an adjective. So by natural instinct, we would think that adding Lee at the end would create an adverb. So these two words will be very close to each other. Unfortunately, not, because hard is easy to guess, is easy to apply in phrases, but hardly gets a completely different meaning. Hardly means nothing, almost nobody. Yes. So she hardly knows him because they met only once. Means that this knowledge of him is very small. Overtake and take over. The switch of take and over changes the meaning. So if we're in the car, we can say to the driver, that's a dangerous place to overtake. You can't see other cars. But we can also overtake other bikers while riding a bicycle, or we can overtake other runners if we're running in a street run, or even pedestrians in the street. While to take over means to get ownership of something else. Usually in business, it refers to the situations when one company buys another one. So IBM, like in the example, IBM is taking over the smaller IT company. Politics and policy. Referring to recent elections, we can say that we had a lot of politics and still we are having a lot of politics on our media and we are talking about politics. So this is, you know, the whole collection of things which are happening within the state, connected with the structure of the state, parties, political system, etc. So this is politics. And definitely during our seminar, we are not going to talk about politics. And policy is more like strategy. So you can use it as the synonyms. And if something goes wrong, you can say, oh, it's definitely, or this is definitely against the company policy. Quite and quiet. The change of two letters, the change of position of two letters makes the meaning different and, of course, the pronunciation different. So quiet is, its role is like intensifier. So we want to intensify the word interesting. It was quite interesting argument. And quiet means silent, without any noise, like you want a quiet room in the hotel, or you say, oh, please be quiet, the meeting is in progress. Lucky and happy. You can be happy but not lucky, or you can be lucky but not happy. In Polish, we've got only one word for that. Lucky, you're lucky when something around you, something external happens. You win on the lottery, like in the example, the police arrived on time. Some external circumstances make you feel good. But being happy is very internal feeling, right? So I was so happy when they announced the results. It's your feeling. It's how you feel at the moment. As I said before, you know, these two words are excluding sometimes themselves because there are people who are extremely lucky, but they are unhappy. And at the same time, you've got people who are inside happy and quiet and satisfied with their life, although external circumstances don't prove that. Do you know this pair? Desert and dessert. Slightly different accent. Have you ever been to the Sahara Desert, which is usually a big sandy and hot area? And dessert is something that you eat at the end of the main course. Beside and besides. Beside defines the position. So who is standing beside your boss? Besides is a linking word. Usually it's used as the opening phrase at the beginning of the sentence, like besides making money, the company aims to set high standards of quality. Employer and employee. I guess that most of us are employees because employer is organization, person, company, which employs people, hires people, and we are employees, so we are subject to employment. Discover and invent. We can discover things which have already existed, but nobody knew about them. And that's the case with Christopher Columbus, who invented, sorry, oh, who discovered America. But as people say, it's very probable that Vikings had done this before him. And of course, invent, which slipped my mind, is creating something completely new. It can be, I don't know, a service, thing, object, machine. We can ask who on earth invented the engine. Alone and lonely. It's very similar case like with lucky and happy. Because Home Alone, do you remember the film in Polish? It's translated into Kevin Sam w domu. Every Christmas we have a chance to watch it on Polsat. It's kind of a tradition now. I'm half joking. But you're alone physically, right? If you're lonely, it means that you feel lonely inside. Here like this, Mike, after divorce. So you can be alone, but you don't feel lonely. And you can be lonely, although you're surrounded by a lot of people. Sensible and sensitive. Sensible is like reasonable, good, well thought. So this seems to be a sensible price. If you see a good product, and the price is not very high, you can say that, oh, it was a very sensible decision. So it was good, well thought over. And sensitive is delicate, fragile, like people. And also we can say that politics, sex, and religion are sensitive subjects. Recipe and receipt. Recipe is some kind of list of activities that you have to do in order to achieve something. Like you would like to make a cheesecake. So you need a recipe for that with ingredients and the way of preparing, right? We can also say metaphorically, what is their recipe for success? Or what is your recipe for happiness? You are in such good relationship. And receipt is a very small piece of paper that you get from the shop or from the parcel meter. I lost my receipt from the shop and now I can't refund my shoes, for example. Okay, some more. We first take an exam and we don't know whether we would pass it. So before results, you say, I took an exam or I'm taking an exam tomorrow. But after you know you passed it, you can say, I passed the exam. So never ever in English you can say, I'm passing my exam tomorrow. That's wrong. That's the mistake. Okay, so glasses on. So it's time for quiz. If we have three examples, the first one, she studied what at London University? What did she study? And the second one, it was only last year that we were overtaken or taken over by the investment fund. And the third one, last but not the least, my team works very hard or very hardly. Could you please write in the chat box the version that you think is correct? Okay. I can see a lot of good, correct answers. Yes. So now we can, yeah, Adrian, Małgorzata, Sławomir, Mateusz. Yes, right. Ewa, Sławomir, Dominik, Ania. Wow. Great. Fantastic. So here are the answers. She studied economics at London University. It was only last year that we were taken over by the investment fund. And the last one, my team works very hard. Okay, thank you. That was great. And now we are looking at the next group of confusing areas of English language. These are called homophones. So they sound the same. There's the same pronunciation, but they have different spelling and they have different meaning. Look at these two words. In writing, it's perfect. We are very comfortable because we can see the graphics of these words. But when people speak, especially they speak rapidly, it's very easy to confuse the message that is given by your speaker. So if somebody says it very quickly, let's meet to eat some meat, well, you need a second to think what kind of meat is in what place of the sentence. The same with this pair, weather and weather. Exactly the same pronunciation, but the first word means if, and of course the second one means the set of natural conditions which surround us every day. Okay? So please check whether the weather is good for tomorrow's picnic. Of course, we can say, please check if the weather is good for tomorrow's picnic, but this is our choice. But if we hear a sentence like that, we need to be sure that we understood correctly. That's the difference between production, so what you say, and the knowledge that you have about English, that's perfect. We are absolutely sufficient with what we know. But there is another side of knowing languages. We must be aware of what somebody else is telling us. And if it comes to native speakers, it's difficult. That's why we are going into such details of languages. Steal and steal, long E. Why did he steal so much steel? Okay. Flower and flower. I'm sure that you know the first one perfectly well. What's your favorite flower? But the second one has exactly the same pronunciation. It's written in completely different form. But this is the white powder that you use for making cakes or pasta or any kind of dough. How much flour do you need for chocolate cupcakes? Pair and pair. I need to buy a new pair of shoes. And the second one is a fruit. Very often mispronounced. The correct pronunciation is pear. Is it an apple? No, it's a pear. Eight and eight. The past tense of the word eat is pronounced exactly like the number eight. So he feels sick because he ate seven or eight pears. Red and red. The first one is the color. The second one is the past form of the verb to be. So I can't remember what book he read. Definitely it had a red cover. Weigh and weigh. In what way can you weigh a heavy animal? If we go to the airport at the check-in, the first thing they do, they weigh our luggage. So please bear in mind that this verb, which looks a bit complicated in writing, is pronounced very nicely the same as the word weigh. Scent and scent. I can see a lot of female participants tonight, and I guess that you've got your favorite perfume, and in English it's called scent. What a lovely scent of roses. The same pronunciation as a small unit of dollar. Actually, you can buy it just for a few cents. Well, homophones are tricky because they don't come only in pairs. Sometimes you've got three words which are pronounced exactly the same, but as we said before, they differ both in spelling and in meaning. Here we've got the example of peace, pronounced with long E. United Nations or UN troops were sent for a new peacemaking mission. Would you like a piece of cake or a piece of pizza? And very small green vegetables, which we use for salads, for soups, vegetable soups are called peas, and they belong to the family of peas, beans, or lentils. Sail and sail. We will sail for Havana early in the morning. It means that you will go by boat, the boat which would have a sail on it. And seasonal discounts in shops are called sales. I bought this coat on a winter sale. Sight and sight. Sight, I can see you, so you're within my sight. And sometimes we say that people met and it was love at the first sight. So it means that at the very first moment of their meeting, they were attracted to each other. So I can't stand the sight of blood. Well, that's the opposite, of course. and sight is a place. So this is a site for the new factory, or this is a site for the new building in the center of Warsaw. And here we've got the example. We visited the site of the Battle of Waterloo. Mist and mist. The first one, the first one is a very delicate fog. You can also have a mist of perfume. So when you spray perfume, you can see a very delicate kind of, I don't know how to call it, a collection of little drops. So this is it. And mist is the past form of the verb miss. Just a mist of perfume, not more, because it will be too smelly. And John missed the best part of the presentation. Okay, glasses on, little quiz. So we've got three pronunciations, three phonetic versions of verbs, of verbs we've been looking at, meet, peace, and weigh. You won't be surprised if I ask you to write in the chat box what words are pronounced in the same way. Okay, Mateusz, great. Meet, meet, peace, 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 way, way. Missed, missed. Yeah, you spotted quite a lot of them. Thank you. Ewa, Elżbieta, Sławomir, right. So, pronunciation meet goes with two. Pronunciation peace goes with three. And pronunciation way goes with two. Right, minimal pairs. By minimal pairs, we understand words which differ only by very small element. In English, it's usually the length of the vowel. Vowel, I, E, U, O. Look at this. This is a ship, and on the ship, we've got sheep, yes, ship and sheep. We don't hear it that well because our ear is not tuned to British pronunciation, English pronunciation. But surprisingly enough, we also have minimal pairs in Polish, which are also difficult for foreigners. If you think about pair like Kasia and Kasia, for us, it's clear, but speak to, I don't know, an Englishman or a Spaniard, and they would say they can't hear the difference. The same goes with the pair proszę and proszę. So she and she are minimal pairs in our language. In English, very often it's ü and i that make difference. Now we're looking very briefly at the two columns in which you will see how words differ, although they are pronounced almost identically, but the only difference between them in pronunciation is this length of E and the meaning changes. So if your E is not long enough, you say something completely different. Or if your E is not short enough, you express different things. Sometimes it's neutral, it's okay, but at the end of this table you would see that some of them are confusing, it's not enough. They are offensive or they are taboo words, so we need to be especially careful with them. And of course I haven't said that at the beginning of our presentation, but all materials you will get at the beginning of next week, and everything will be there, so you don't need to take notes. Everything will be explained, translated, so it will come to your mailbox. So just a few minimal pairs: bin and bean, chip and cheap, fill and feel, fit and feet, grin and green, hit and heat, still and steel. Steel has already appeared a few slides before. Lick and leak, bit and beat, hail. Here we've got two others which sound exactly the same. They are homophones, heel and heel, knit and neat, pick and peek, sin and seen. And now we come to those vulgar ones: piss and peace, bitch and beach. There is a difference if you go to the beach or if you go to the bitch. And of course, last but not the least, is the one that we have to be very careful. There is a famous anecdote about Polish nurses which used to work in England during the war, and they didn't know English very well, And they wanted to be very helpful for wounded soldiers. And they asked, oh, sorry, would you mind if I change your shits? Well, of course, the message was completely different because they wanted to change bed sheets and make their beds clean. So careful, especially with these three last ones. Okay? Do you remember any of minimal pairs? Anything stayed in your mind? Of course, I told you that you'll get materials, but anything comes to your mind which you can write down in the chat box as the minimal pair? Anyone? Any examples of minimal pairs? Knit and knead, bit and bead, great. Ship and sheep. Yeah, a lot of answers. Marta, Mateusz, Sławomir, Ewa, Elżbieta. Great. Ola, Agnieszka. Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, so you're listening. It's, you know, great motivation. Thank you. Let's move on. Another group of confusables, as I call them, are homographs. And these gentlemen, they have the same spelling, but different pronunciation and different meaning. Well, life of a student is difficult, isn't it? So we've got this word. I'm not going to pronounce it because you see the graphic form. And now let's pronounce it this way. Lead. Gold is heavier than lead. If you pronounce this word this way, you will refer to the metal, yes? And for example, we use in our cars petrol, which is without lead, and it's green sign, and we call it unleaded petrol. But if you pronounce this word in different way, like lead, you will get a different meaning. So the same graphic representation, but different pronunciation and different meaning. A good boss should lead the team. I'm not going to pronounce it because we can have two pronunciations. If we say wind, we refer to some rapid action in the air. In autumn, we can come across strong winds. Yeah, so wind howled through woodlands. And if we pronounce it like wind your watch, because it's going to stop, we refer to the action of turning winder, this little element, in order to make our clocks going. Of course, these days, it's less and less used because everything is, you know, electronics, we've got batteries and other stuff. But winders still exist, and if you wind something, it means that you do something to keep it going. Okay, another homograph, which, if pronounced like minute, refers to the unit of time, right? That's simple. But you can pronounce it also in this way, minute. Minute means very small, so that refers to the volume. I don't know, he bought a minute amount of, what? For example, illegal substance. So it means very, very small. Don't be surprised if you hear it this way. This one refers to the action. I don't want to do anything wrong here, but if I have a piece of paper and I want to destroy it, I tear it, right? But if I watch the movie, or if I get bad news, or I'm sad or depressed, something wrong happens, there are tears running down my cheeks. So tear, different action, and tears going down. In homographs, also stress can cause the change of the meaning. Because if we put the stress on the first syllable, we've got the noun, transport. If we put it on the second syllable, we've got the verb, transport. So, improved rail transport is essential for business. We need to transport all these goods to Japan. Produce, which is noun, and to produce, action. Lots of quality produce is produced by Polish farmers. Project, to project. She manages several projects right now, but the company projects an annual growth rate of 3%. So to project means to predict, to foresee. Permit and to permit. First, they need to go to get job permits. And would you permit your employees to drink at work? And I guess that we're not referring to water, coffee or tea. If you don't mind, I'll take a sip of water. All right, because that reminded me, I'm thirsty. Refund and to refund. They refused to give me a refund for, I don't know, destroyed luggage. And the company refunded my expenses for the business trip. Present and to present. I've got a lovely present from him. Would you like to present the recent sales figures? Increase and to increase. The company noticed a significant increase in sales. So that's the noun. That's the process which happened. If we talk about action, activity, the stress changes. We need to increase our budget for trainings. All right. If you see my glasses, you know it's time for the little quiz. So remember, noun gets accent on the first syllable. Action, the verb, gets accent on the last syllable. So if you see these sentences, what do you think would be the correct answer? We need to expenditures for entertainment, and the latest market showed our main target groups. Okay, yeah, again, very active participation. Sławomir, Mateusz, Ania, Elżbieta, Agnieszka, yes. So we need to decrease expenditures for entertainment, and the latest market research showed our main target groups. Target group, groups. Okay, good, thank you. Well, we are now coming to the last part of our meeting. So we will look at homonyms. So words which look and sound the same. So at this side, it's okay, but they have a completely different meaning. And that's the problem with English. If you open an English dictionary, either virtual or in the form of the book, and you will have a look at, I don't know, the verb to go, you have three pages of meanings, starting from the basic one. And a lot of people ask me, oh, Eva, what is the meaning of this and that in English? And I say, okay, I'll tell you, but first I need to get a context. Because English, not like Polish, English is a very contextual language. So you get the meaning by the sentence, by the surrounding of the word. Okay? So, as I told you, hot verbs, verbs which are used most frequently, statistically, and most frequent verbs in English are those like to get, probably the most universal one. Sometimes I get a feeling that you can speak about everything using get, if we are smart enough, to have, to do, to take, and to go. So depending how you put, how you insert this verb into the context, into the phrase, sentence, story, it could get a completely different meaning, not to mention phrasal verbs, but this is the subject for the next webinar. Look at the verb band. The first connotation is a group, a music group. Yes, so it was one of the most famous bands in the world. Band is also a kind of fabric which women put on their hair in order to look nice or to keep them in order. There's also another meaning of this word, which I didn't put on the slide, which you are, when you are talking about a wide band in terms of internet or radio frequency, so it's connected with waves and transmission of data. The word bank is obvious. Yes, we use banks every day and we know what's the meaning, but we also say bank if we refer to the piece of land which is on the border of the river, of the lake, or the lake. Yes, or the lake. So if we say to our friend, okay, so let's meet today at the bank, you need to be more specific and say, oh, at the Bank of Vistula or at the Millennium Bank at, I don't know, Francuska Street. So context is important. But we are approaching Halloween season, so you can see a lot of Halloween decorations in places. Bat is a creature, it's an animal. That's why we have Batman. But bat is also usually wooden stick used to play baseball. Fair play. So acting according to the rules in the gentleman, honest way. But fair is also maybe not color, but some kind of shade. So it means pale, light. Nicole Kidman, she has very pale complexion and pale hair. So we can say fair complexion, fair face, fair hair. Fair has additional meaning. Fair is a market. It's used mostly in countryside to describe a traditional meeting connected sometimes with some celebrations. Okay, ground, you know it, I'm sure. Yes, this is ground. But ground is also a word that you can find at the package of coffee. And it says ground coffee. Does it mean that this coffee comes from the ground? Yes, of course it does because it grows. But ground coffee is the coffee which is not in beans, but it's a coffee powder. Because ground is the third form of the verb to grind. So you grind pepper, you grind coffee, and from beans you receive powder. A tip is a kind of advice. So if you're going to London, your friend can give you some tips what to do there or what to see, what to visit. Tip is also a small amount of money that you give if we are satisfied with the service. Tip is also a very end. So tip of an iceberg. Or sometimes we use this kind of statement in English. Oh, I forgot this word, but I've got it at the tip of my tongue. We have exactly the same saying in Polish. Well, thank you for your presence tonight and for very, very active participation. It was a pleasure to host you. And I hope that our meeting gave you some flavor of what we should be aware of while we're learning English and while we're using it. As I said before, materials will come to you at the beginning of next week. If you have any questions, please do ask now or write in emails. Okay? Thank you very much for your active participation. Enjoy the evening and good night. See you.